Well, another figure today that might be a bit troubling. Vaccine hesitancy, 29% the total category, either not getting it or unlikely to get the vaccine. What will that mean for our future and how do we get it higher? Joining me now live is my panel, Liberal MP Tim Wilson from the Labor Party, Josh Burns. Tim, beginning with you, Scott Morrison says 70% is pretty good for now. That doesn't seem to be aiming high. Shouldn't we be tackling this vaccine hesitancy now?
Well, we are tackling the vaccine hesitancy now. We're working directly with communities to make sure that those who are eligible to get vaccinated are getting vaccinated, but we're not going to force things into people's bodies, and we've got to build confidence. And that's why we've had doctors giving advice and been using them as a vehicle to build confidence within the community. And it's also why we've had public health professionals out there making the case about why it's good to have vaccinations. But this is a responsibility of every Australian. I'll be getting the jab when I'm eligible, and I encourage others to do so as well.
So do you think there's been enough? I've barely cited advertising on this, I've got to say.
Well, one of the things we've done is clearly work through doctors and primary health clinicians, because they're the people that people have the hesitancy about a vaccination. They turn to for advice and assistance. And so we are providing advice. I've no doubt there'll be continue to be more advice into the future as the rollout goes on. Many Australians have taken the opportunity, but I absolutely want to see more Australians getting vaccinated. And, you know, to the extent that able, will lead by example by getting the jab myself, and I encourage others to do the same.
Josh Burns, again, this comment from the Prime Minister, he thinks 70% is a pretty good figure for now. What do you think?
Well, the Australian people have been magnificent throughout this entire pandemic. They've listened to the health experts, they've made huge sacrifices, they've done everything that we've asked of them to keep everyone else safe. And I think it's really important that we acknowledge that Australians have done an amazing job throughout this pandemic. But the biggest barrier, the biggest issue in our vaccine rollout is not the Australian people. The biggest issue in our vaccine rollout in getting jabs in people's arms is this federal government. They promised there'd be 4 million vaccines by the end of March. Well, that didn't happen. They promised Australians would be at the head of the queue. Well, that obviously wasn't the case. They promised even recently that aged care staff and residents, or especially residents, would be done by the end of the month. And yesterday we found out that only 999 people in the disability sector have had a vaccine. You want to know where the problem is in the rollout of this vaccine, in getting jabs in Australians' arms? It's not with the Australian people, it's with the Australian government. And Scott Morrison's promises but no delivery but isn't good enough.
What do you think of the 70%, seemingly the PM happy enough with that? Should the government be more ambitious in terms of how many people it wants to get vaccinated?
Well, clearly, the amount of mixed messages that we've had from the government has been really problematic as well. First of all, we were on a war footing, and then we were meeting twice a week in National Cabinet, and then we're back to once a month, and then, you know, any suggestion that we hurry along the vaccine was dangerous. I mean, the government has been completely all over the shop. And for a guy that sort of pretends and, you know, sometimes calls himself a marketing man, he's really failed on this one. I think we need a clear message. Vaccines are crucial, and we need the federal government to make sure that Australians have access to vaccines as quickly and easy as possible.
Tim, you're a free market man. What do you make of the government intervening in the market today for the Kurri Kurri gas-fired power plant?
Well, I am a free market man, but one of the challenges with energy security is you need to mobilise capital over decade-long returns. So you need government confidence to provide private sector confidence as well. And we made it quite clear as a government that if there wasn't the investment in new energy generation so we could keep prices low we couldn't deliver the reliable energy security the country needs, as well as being part of a transition to a lower carbon future, then the government would have no choice but to step up. I think a lot of the energy companies didn't take us seriously, because what they wanted to do was exploit record prices and monopoly gains. And what we're saying is we're serious. We want cheaper prices for households. We want reliable energy security for the country. And we want to drive the transition to a lower carbon future. And we do that passionately and with a clear commitment, because we know that underwriting cheap energy provides jobs, to keep jobs in Australians, to drive manufacturing and other sectors so that we can build the success and the future of Australia's economic base.
Josh, your colleague Joel Fitzgibbon gave this a big thumbs up. What about you?
Tom, I mean, I'm fond of Tim and he's my electorate neighbour, but what a load of nonsense. These people are not free market believers. They believe in fighting the market. The market has been desperate for energy policy in this country. They've been desperate for a framework, desperate for some sort of policy leadership from this government so that they can invest. If you want cheap and affordable energy, you need renewable energy firmed with some sort of dispatchable power. That is what we need in this country to bring down electricity prices, to bring down the amount of emissions.
It's gas.
Yeah, but it's not low emissions, and it's $600 million that the federal government is spending of taxpayer funds. Last week, the Northern Australian Infrastructure Fund recommended...
Leading up to the last election?
Tom, last week, the federal government was advised by an independent body to build a wind farm in the Northern Territory.
It's actually in the policy platform of the Labor Party to support gas, and they see it as part of the transition to a lower carbon future over the next 20 to 30 years.
Tim, there is a difference... There's a difference between gas playing a role in feedstock and other manufacturing needs, which of course, it has a role to play in the future. But what we need to do is build our energy grid and our energy capabilities, not just for tomorrow, but for 10 years, for 20 years. What are we going to be looking like? That's why we committed to rewiring the grid.
That's why we have a net zero emission target. Is that what you're saying?
Curry is $600 million of taxpayer funds that's going to drive up electricity, drive up emissions. It is not a good deal for taxpayers, and it is not in the interests of taxpayers to be spending this. What we need is a national energy policy. We need leadership from the Prime Minister, and instead we're getting Angus Taylor giving money back, which this lands on a Liberal Party donor as well.
Because Alan Finkel himself, a former chief scientist, has outlined very spectacularly how false it is to suggest that using gas is actually going to drive up emissions. One of the reasons why we're utilising gas is we're seeing the decommissioning of coal, and gas is a transition fuel, not just because it itself is a transition fuel, but the infrastructure can then be used for no emissions hydrogen into the future. It's a difference between the opposition policy by snark versus government policy by action.
Okay, Tim, just very quickly to finish on this, do you think currently the Australian government is doing enough to repatriate citizens from India?
We're working on it, and there needs to be more to continue to be worked done to make sure that we can get as many Australians home. And I've supported measures that the government has taken. As I said, we've done things, and there is more to be done. And we'll have supported consistently the government taking further measures. Well, we've been making sure that repatriation flights have been available. We've expanded the use of quarantine facilities. All of these measures are critically important to get Australians home. And we've done them in the past, and we should continue to do them because Australians overseas, I've said consistently, should be able to return home if they're able to do so.
I remain intrigued by the more element, but the bells are ringing for the show at least. Tim, Josh, thank you. Talk again soon when we come back.